Welcome, everyone, to No Dumb Questions. It's a feature of the Ricochet Network, but you got to be a Ricochet member to listen to it. So if you are hearing this on some, you know, torrented file you got from the deep web, shame on you. Didn't you learn anything from those Interpol warnings before the DVDs? No. So this is for Ricochet members, and they're here. They're gathered, ready to ask questions of our guest, who is so many things: author, fountain pen enthusiast, stereo gear knowledgeable guy, and of course, he does some dabbling on the radio as well. Dennis Prager, welcome to No Dumb Questions.
It's great to be with you, and you gave me permission to smoke my cigar.
Oh, who am I to tell Dennis Prager not to smoke his cigar?
I ask. You know, I'm sure there are people who would be concerned about secondhand smoke, and I just want to be nice.
Broadband isn't so good at this point that actually the wafting of the cigar aroma can come through my speakers. But I almost wish that it was, because I'll bet it's something fine and aromatic, and right. I envy you it. Well, I'm not going to start with a dumb question about cigars. I'd love to, maybe, if we have time. I mean, the whole idea of the dumb question, I get that in the interests of, if we approach intellectual inquiry with a philanthropic spirit, there are no dumb questions. Anything you have to say is good. But on the other hand, some questions just do strike one as dumb. So let me ask you and get this out of the way. Do you think the question, what is a woman, is a dumb question?
Not today. That's the tragedy. It would have been dumb at any time in the history of mankind. It would have been dumb among tribes that were illiterate. It is only among the well-educated in America that question is not dumb. That's how sad things have become.
But do you think the people who are loath to answer it do so because they honestly don't know? We know so much new now. Things are changing. Or because they fear the result of actually answering the question as they believe it to be true?
Oh, I believe it is the latter. Absolutely. And certainly in the case of the judge at the hearings, she's afraid from anything she says will cause her problems. If she actually gives woman a definition, then the left will hate her because they don't believe there is an objective definition to man or woman. And if she says, well, it's whatever people think, if anyone who thinks that they are, I'll use they here, that they are a woman, is a woman, then she looks like a fool to the less educated.
I don't know, you know. To be put in that position to have to not answer that question in a national forum would be mortifying.
To say, no, her answer is scary. That's right.
It's interesting.
I'm not a biologist. Did you catch that?
I did. Ergo, it is a matter of biology. Are they going to let her slide on that is the question.
That's right. Yes. Well said. I pointed that out too. Yeah.
Yet, you know, it reminds you of the things that Solzhenitsyn said about living in the Soviet Union, where everybody spoke a lie that they knew was a lie, and everybody knew that it was assumed by all to be a lie, yet the lie had to be spoken. And then it also reminds you of Orwell's Newspeak in 1984 and the perversion of language in that way. I've never actually seen this sort of self-muzzling and consensual delusion take root as quickly as it did. So my question to you, perhaps before we go to some of the questions of the people, and of course about your book, is this the natural end result of the long march through the institutions of dissolving nearly every single bourgeois concept, this proves that they've won on every front, and now they're doing cleanup work with things like this, with things like who is a woman?
Well, the possible hope. And I'm not a born optimist, but I don't believe in pessimism either. But I just believe in calling things as they are. There is some hope. The level of absurdity of, for example, having a man, a biological male, if you wish, compete in women's sports, I think they're getting to the point where, again, unless you went to graduate school, you might in fact realize we're going crazy. Mm-hmm. I will say though that I believe this is a function of the following. the famous G.K. Chesterton quote, when people stop believing in God, they don't believe in anything, they believe in nothing. Mm-hmm. Excuse me, they don't believe in nothing, they believe in anything. This, I don't know what a man is or men menstruate, is the direct result, I believe. A lot of secular conservatives don't agree with me, and that's fine, they're my allies, but they're wrong. This is definitely a post-Judeo-Christian concept. Even an atheist can acknowledge, and Douglas Murray, I don't know if he's an atheist, but he's certainly a secular man and gay and one of the great thinkers of our time. And he is adamant that the post-Christian vacuum produces this sort of absurdity.
Well, that brings us nicely to your book. The book is The Rational Passover Haggadah, and it's brought to us by Regnery. Before we get to the pith of the gist of the book, dumb question. Haggadah, what is it?
Right. So I gambled by using the actual term, because nobody knows what it is except a handful of Jews. It's actually Haggadah or Haggadah. So you have three choices, and you pick the one syllable it isn't ever
based pronounced. On Google, which apparently has got some other North Dakota goyim like myself running their pronunciation thing. I checked it out before we came.
That is hilarious. They said Haggadah?
Accent on the first syllable.
Oh, that is hilarious. Virtually no Hebrew word with three syllables begins on the first syllable. That's a riot.
I didn't think so. I mean, yeah. Haggadah.
Or either Haggadah or Haggadah. Anyway, it doesn't matter. I don't care if you call it Haggadah. It's irrelevant because nobody knows what it is. But the oldest holiday in the world is Passover. It's been observed for 3,000 years. And this is the service of the Seder, the Passover meal. Many Christians are now having Passover Seder to tie them to their biblical roots, even their Jewish roots. And in part because Jesus's Last Supper is widely believed to have been the Passover Seder. So what I decided to do is take a break from my rational Bible series. Deuteronomy is coming out in October, so that will be three of the five volumes of the first five volumes. Genesis and Exodus are out. Deuteronomy is in October, and I decided to do the Passover thing. And even if one reads it as a book, people could read the reviews on Amazon and see how it affects their lives. So this is to explain the most ancient holiday. And I'll just give you one example. I make the point in it, and this is so relevant to our time. The secret to Jewish survival for 3,500 years is ritual, memory and ritual. And the secret to America's demise is the death of memory and ritual. We had rituals for July 4th. We had rituals for Thanksgiving. We had rituals for Memorial Day. And they, of course, July 4th is now a day for hot dogs and beer, which is fine, but it was a day that really meant something. If we won't survive the death of ritual, and the left, which wants us not to survive as a distinctive entity, they don't realize fully how accurate they are in killing Thanksgiving, for example, and making it Indigenous Peoples Day. And making Christmas into Happy Holiday instead of Merry Christmas, and Holiday Party instead of Christmas Party. The demise of America's holidays cannot be survived.
There's a human need for memory and ritual. In every society you have.
What
do they want to replace them with then?
I'll tell you. There are left-wing rituals, like what's your preferred pronoun? I'm not kidding. That is a left-wing ritual. They're adamant about that at colleges. That's the way you introduce yourself. They not only kill the traditional rituals of America, they supplant them with their own. We had a Pledge of Allegiance. Pete Buttigieg's husband is on, you could see it on the internet, leading kids in the pledge to the gay liberation flag.
Mm-hmm. Right. But the things that you just mentioned, Thanksgiving, Decoration Day, the 4th, all of those things, all of those rituals that we have, if the left wants to replace them, supplant them with things, as you said, the statement of pronouns, the dedication, the announcement of where you stand in the intersectional grievance pyramid, all the rest of that. It's not the same. I mean, it's just simply replacing ritual with an expression of dogma, which cannot fill that human need.
That is entirely accurate. That's one of the reasons that I have so often noted. I have met happy and unhappy liberals, happy and unhappy conservatives, but I've never met a happy leftist. The absence of all these meaningful things in their lives, and you know, which is supplanted by, well, I will save the world against climate change, which is a big deal that you're saving the world, that gives you meaning. But they are the product. I have an equation. They are the product of boredom, secularism, and affluence. Those three together are the brew that produces leftism.
Right. Was the question that the statement that all the troubles in the world can be laid at the feet of a man who is unable to sit by himself in a room at 2 o'clock in the morning. The book then. So the promotional material for the book had some interesting questions. And I looked at these and I thought, you're probably going to get these in your tour. So let's help you prep here, because I'm going to throw you some things. I don't know if you talked to your publicist, that maybe you haven't thought about. So this might be the first time that these questions are being put to you. The first question in the promotional material was, how important is God to the meaning of life, to meaning in life? Now, I know I'm throwing you a curveball here that you maybe not have thought about, but let's just assume that you have.
Well, and ask. I just want all your listeners to understand that I deal with these big questions in this. That's why this is right. For non-Jews, Jews, atheists, believers, it doesn't matter. The answer is clear. The answer is clear to every great secular or atheist, even atheist thinker. They acknowledge that without God, there is no ultimate meaning to life. But since no one can live without meaning, it's impossible. You go out of your mind. And therefore, they construct, and that's what existentialism is. Life doesn't have any inherent meaning. We are just biospheres with self-consciousness. We have to give it meaning. So the meaning will come from environmentalism or feminism or communism or Marxism or any of the innumerable isms of secular life. But without God, objectively speaking, there is, of course, no ultimate meaning. You drop dead, and that's it for eternity. And on this earth, the few years that we have, we try to make the best, obviously, but nobody could stare in the mirror in the morning and go, how you doing, you meaningless puff of molecules? So people make up stuff. But ultimately, if there is no God, there is no soul, there is no meaning.
Well, when I look at myself in the mirror, I'm not wearing my glasses, so I usually say, hey, they're handsome. But I get what you mean.
That's what men do, by the way. Women right. Never go, how you doing, beautiful?
Yeah, no, they got a primp, they got a pluck. So you personally, though, I mean, taking off, running from what you just said, do you think it's necessary to have a particular conception of God in order to have the meaning that religion brings? In other words, the idea that most have is an interventionist God with whom one has a lifelong dialogue. You can appeal to God. God will answer in strange ways, maybe not immediately apparent to you, but there's a dynamic between the two of you. Is that required, or can one be satisfied in a metaphysical sense with the idea of a interested but remote, not involved deist idea of a God? In other words, as long as we know that there is an order and a purpose and a creation to all this, is it necessary for happiness to sit down and have a rap session with a big guy, as they used to say in the 60s?
It's a very, very good question. It's actually an original question, which is pretty rare for a guy who gets questioned a lot. My instinctive reaction is that Zeus gave Romans meaning. So I would say that in terms of meaning alone and not morality, that's a separate issue and the biggest one for me. you can get meaning from all sorts of gods, your Aztec god, your even remote god. If there is this metaphysical creator, that can help give meaning. So I would not say that the only source of meaning is the Judeo-Christian conception of a god. I would say, however, that morally speaking, that's the only god that I think works. The god of the Ten Commandments is the way I put it. I'm a religious Jew, but I don't care if another person expresses their God-centeredness through Judaism or Christianity, or any of its manifestations, Protestant, Catholic, Mormon, that's fine. As long as you believe that God is the author of the Ten Commandments, that's my bottom line. If your God did not reveal a moral will, that's not my God.
Mm-hmm. All right, the Roman gods were all over the map when it came to morals and behavior.
Right, yes. The purpose of those gods was to propitiate them.
Right.
Not live a good life and honor them that way.
No. So along comes a unipolar, a monotheistic idea that completely upends what they think. And you can understand why it was as controversial as it was. And do you wonder sometimes, looking back at human history, whether or not we're getting to Christianity here, the change from the empire to its pagan state to its Christian state was more political than it happened to be religious? Or was it a sign of a society, perhaps like ours, that had exhausted itself, that had eaten all of its seed corn and was due for some new cathartic break with their previous paradigms? I mean, now we're all terrified because we see all of our institutions failing us. We saw it happen in the pandemic. We see it happen politically. We see the international order of the post-war era all breaking down. We're seeing everything fall, and we're wondering what comes along. Is this era, everybody likes to think they're like the Romans, but is this era perhaps analogous to that time in Rome when they too had been morally exhausted and were casting about for something new?
Yes, but ironically, I don't know what could be an improvement on the Judeo-Christian and American mm-hmm. value systems. That's why I said boredom plus affluence plus secularism. See, the poor have meaning, even whether they believe in God or not. Poor people have inherent meaning. And that is, I got to find out how I can get lunch and dinner for my family. That's very, very meaningful. And I say that absolutely sincerely. Mm-hmm. The rich have a very serious meaning problem because that has been robbed from them. So if they're also secular, there is a deep ennui. It's better than the word boredom, but I use the word boredom. It's an ennui. It's soul deep. The boredom. And so they need to find meaning. And there's meaning in victimhood in this country. There is meaning in saving the planet. I mean, can you imagine that? Save all of mankind? You know, Al Gore, who strikes me as affluent, secular, he may have some religiosity. I'm not going to deny it, but he strikes me as bored and needed meaning. He's going to save the world. And that whole crowd, that's why they're almost all, is there a poor environmentalist? I don't know one. The whole movement is basically rich, secular people who are thrilled with themselves that they will save the planet. I mean, you can't get better than that. I mean, I hope to have influence, but I have no belief that I will save by the biological biosphere, to be redundant. they believe that's huge.
I think you underestimate yourself, Dennis. That cigar is putting out the carbon impact of the plumes that are coming from that thing. I think, you know, when I'm sitting in my office building alone, it's a 50-story office tower that's about 5% populated because nobody wanted to go back to work, I often find myself bored and alone. It does not occur to me that the answer to this is to destroy the elevators that get me up and down, wreck the heating, ventilation, and air conditioning system, and undermine the foundations that keep the 50-story skyscraper.
Well, because if you really are bored, and I wonder if you are, because I suspect you have a very lively mind and probably don't get that bored. But even if you were, it's momentary. Their boredom is 24/7. So they must fill that vacuum with something that gets them excited. And it's exciting. It's like a child gets some excitement from rebelling against his parent.
I was going to say, it's adolescent.
Yes. Well, they are adolescents. The woman at Yale Law School, to her credit, a professor, which is rare, actually yelled at the students who were screaming curses at the conservative woman who was there to speak from the Alliance Defending Freedom. She said, grow up. And that drove them out of their minds.
Exactly.
But that's exactly what they are. They are truly children. Mm-hmm. We are governed by children. Everything has been taken over by children. And the New York Times is run by children, and the universities are, your child is taught by a child in an adult body. It's a very serious problem, the immaturity of vast numbers of our fellow citizens.
I can understand the Yale students being upset. Hey, if I was an adult, they wouldn't have lent me $280,000 to pay for this education. But they are, in a sense, that they can't stand to hear what they don't want to hear. But it comes back to the question of, is it this nihilism that we see, this desire to transform, fundamentally transform, as a man once said, America, is this because they have thought this through and believe that we can somehow seamlessly transition to a more just and ecologically fair system without losing any of the advantages and privileges and wonders of this nation? Or do they truly want to scour it down to year zero in a Soviet Cambodia fashion and reconstruct from the ashes something that they think will, of course, include them at the very top, since they're the smart people who know how this is done?
I don't think they reflect long enough to realize what the consequences of their wishes would be. Mm-hmm. But I think some of them would, in fact, be willing to go to a pre-energy age. And they have some romantic vision of just walking or riding. Well, I'm not sure they would ride an animal, because animal rights advocates might object to that.
You need consent first.
Well, and since you can't get it, ironically, combined with the animal rights movement, for which I have some sympathy, but not nearly as much as they would want, we would be actually prehistoric, because they rode animals. Mm-hmm. Interestingly, the Native American did not ride animals. The horse was introduced by Europeans. So they didn't, you don't ride a buffalo. And so, it would end up very much like a Native American life, which they glamorize. So a lot of these, well, again, only the well-educated. I can't emphasize often enough how much education renders one a fool. And you're not born a fool. Kids understand certain things. A 10-year-old would understand that if we had equity in sports, a lot of the people who are stars would no longer be allowed to play, because there isn't equity in sports via talent, or in football and basketball, or for that matter, hockey, by race. So they don't think this through.
No. I mean, when you were saying about it would be impossible to get the animals' consent to ride them to work, I think that they might, you know, somebody might say, well, we could get the hoof of the horse dipped in ink and then stamped on vellum, and that would be the papers that you would give if you were pulled over for speeding in place of your license. But of course, the society that they propose doesn't have ink after a while, and it doesn't have vellum after a while, and everything else that human industry has created would evaporate in this wonderful ideal agrarian nonsense that they keep talking about. or at least that they lionize as the true state of man, the state of nature. One of the things that they don't like about the modern world is the fact that this planet is infested with people. They don't, there's a misanthropy at the heart of this.
That's right.
I was looking at some newspapers the other day, 1967, there was a collection of editorial cartoons collected in the Minneapolis Tribune that all had to do with the specter, the threat of overpopulation. Mm-hmm. It had a stork, huge stork flying over the nation, casting a dark, deep black shadow. This is something we're going to worry about. Too many people. And starting in the whole zero population movement in the 60s and the like, there came to be this idea that we can't reproduce, that to reproduce is bad, that the act of bringing somebody into the world is itself tantamount to a climate crime.
So I wrote a piece, which I would hope your listeners would look up. I have literally exactly 1,000 columns on the internet. So I've been writing
exactly.
Virtually exactly. Because it's 20 years and it's 50 columns a year. So that's 1,000. And one of my recent columns was about a New York Times opinion piece about not having children because of the climate crisis. So I decided I do something that I think everyone who cares about the country should do, read comments on articles. That is truly an insight into where America's minds are at. And in order to comment on the New York Times, you have to be a subscriber to the New York Times. So this isn't just your average Joe. It might be a particularly foolish Joe, but it's not your average Joe. They pay a lot of money to subscribe to the New York Times, as I do, by the way. And so I read the comments on the article. Maybe it's better not to have children at all because of the existential threat of climate change. And I immediately realized I had hit a gold mine. Person after person, and I quoted in my article, says something to this effect. My son or my daughter has decided not to have children because of climate. All of my life I have yearned to have grandchildren, but I agree with my child that I not have a grandchild and that my child not have a child because of the climate crisis. So that proves, by the way, that they do believe their hysteria. This is a quandary for many of us who are not hysterical. Do they really believe this? That's the proof that many of them do. They're willing to forego having a grandchild. They're willing to end their family lineage because of climate change.
It's tossing the baby into the volcano and hoping that the gods react favorably.
Yes.
Baby isn't there yet, but you know, we'll just cut to the chase. In regards to children, one of the questions from the audience here, since everything's being taken over by children or people with a childlike mentality, what do you, Dennis Prager, recommend young or youngish people turn to consider alternative sources of information and instruction? How do kids today navigate this postmodern world and with a mind for their own self-preservation, you know, not saying the wrong thing on Twitter, do they even have the desire to be their true selves? Or, as I believe the question guy was saying, are they more than happy to just adopt the arraignments of leftist intersectionality? Because you know, here's an identity ready-made. People will know who you are. What do they do? What do kids today do?
Well,
besides listen to Dennis Prager and look up your 1,000 articles on the internet.
Right. Besides that, I have a solution. I have an answer. And that's what's animated me my whole life is to try to give people as many answers to these questions, because I better than an answer, I have a solution. But they have been truly indoctrinated against the solution. The solution, there are many ways of phrasing it. Here's one. America has a Trinity just like Christianity does. The American Trinity, I didn't make up. I made up the term, but I didn't make up the content. The content is on every coin. Liberty and God we trust, e pluribus unum. I think that the pursuit of those three things is a massively meaningful life. But there's a big problem. They've been told that God is nonsense, so in God we trust is out. They don't give a damn about liberty. In fact, nearly 50% of kids in college and high school, according to Pew and others, don't believe in free speech. They say they do, but they always add, but not for hate speech, which means they don't believe in free speech. They're so intellectually lost, they don't realize that the whole point of free speech is that you allow the speech that you find hateful. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, the concept is a joke. You might as well say there was free speech in Nazi Germany or in the Soviet Union, because they allowed you to say anything except what they would consider hate speech, namely anything against the regime. So I think that making this wonderful country with liberty of assimilating everybody into an American identity, which doesn't mean you give up your own identity. I didn't give up my Jewishness to be an American. And it's not expected of me. So you don't have to give up some other cultural affinity or religious affinity, but you have to be American. And it's the only way the many will, in fact, get along. Mm-hmm. I keep reading, because I've written a book on happiness. I do a happiness hour every week for an hour, which is what a happiness hour is 1 hour. On my radio show, I'm somewhat of a expert, if you will, on happiness. And these things are available only with this meaning. And here's a happiness thing for you. People don't seek liberty. They seek to be taken care of. Liberty is a value, not a yearning. The human yearning is to be taken care of. That is why the left wins elections all over the world. Mm-hmm. This country was the one non-state-centered country, non-government-centered, non-state-centered country. And that was the giant stride made by the American founding. The individual is of infinite significance, and the state is of minimal significance. But people will always trade in themselves for security, for not even security, just for goodies. Mm-hmm. Give me free health care. Give me free tuition. Give me free lunch. Give me free daycare, and I'll give you my liberty. That's the deal that the left makes, and people are willing to take that deal.
They'll trade liberty for license. One of the questions from the this is from anonymous attendee. These are so petty. These are so small. Okay. Do you believe in an afterlife? And if so, why? And what do you think it's like?
Okay. To me, there's an axiom. If there is a just God, there is an afterlife. And so if you believe in a just God, by definition, there's an afterlife, because there's no justice here or little justice here. If you don't believe in a just God, then there's no afterlife. It's not a complex question. I don't understand people who believe in a just God and don't believe in an afterlife. I totally understand why atheists don't believe in an afterlife. There's nothing to survive my body. There is no soul. So it's not a complex question. I have no idea what happens in the afterlife. Literally, you'll find this amusing. Literally, the only time that I ever think about what happens in the afterlife is when I'm asked what happens in the afterlife. How the hell do I know what happens in the afterlife?
Yeah, right. I think part of it just has to be with a kid sitting in church and hearing about this, and you have no concept except that everybody's on clouds and you have to hang around with your aunt, you know, for eternity. And there's no end.
Which is not all that desirable. So in light of your response, I'll tell you a funny story. I went to yeshiva, which is Jewish religious school, till I was 19, mm-hmm. half the day in Hebrew, half the day in English. So in in my sophomore year in high school, I was somewhat bored in my Bible class, only because I love the Bible, but the teacher was not exactly scintillating. So I raised my hand and said, can I ask a question that has nothing to do with what we're learning? He said, go ahead, Prager, fine. I said, what happens in the afterlife? And he looked at me with total seriousness and said, we study Torah for eternity. And I remember thinking, I give you my word, I remember thinking, well, what's the alternative? It might be better. and I'm writing a Torah commentary. I love those five books. But the thought that that's what I'll do for eternity, and with this guy, no less, struck me as your aunt.
Right. And I loved her, but she smelled a lot of cigarettes all the time. So in a lot, you know, again, as you're a child, you think of people being eternally tortured in pits of fire, and that seems a bit vindictive and a bit explicit and a little too literal and the rest of it. And I mean, you're right. We don't know. We can't. For all we know, there's simply, we are vouchsafed a vision of the way things are and the glories and mysteries of the connected universe. And that's, you know, we get to meet our dog and our loved ones. And
if God
and that's
is it. Just, it's good. And by the way, I completely acknowledge the existence of the bad. If Hitler has the same fate as Mother Teresa, God is not just.
No. Let us pivot quickly to beauty. It's connected to what we were saying. It's another one of those, well, we'd like it. No, I take that back. It's not as deep a human need necessarily as memory and ritual. And beauty is subjective, and people have different meanings for it. Some say, you know, the old Keats line about truth being beauty and vice versa. I'm not exactly sure. I don't find any particular moral. There's nothing inherently moral about something that is beautiful. But we live in an age where we simultaneously have a desire for beauty and an artistic establishment, architectural, painting, visual, and the rest of it, which seems to revel in the mud, which seems to revel in ugliness. The example that you give frequently of the enormous statue of the dog taking, you know, micturating on the museum. What do we do then to restore the primacy of beauty without getting the people who say this torn down and hooted down in the public square? Trump tried to restore the idea of historical architectural American, what was the vernacular, to our public institutions, and was regarded as a fascistic, reveler in old dead tropes. But yet, when people seem to have a choice, they yearn towards the human scaled in architecture, the traditional. They yearn towards the representational, as opposed to something that is just simply a Francis Bacon nightmare of a howling piece of dead beef in a slaughterhouse. How do we get back beauty in our public life? You got a minute on that one, so
I'm fine. That's fine. I'm not sure that secular society is geared for beauty. Beauty. Look, I know music very well. I conduct orchestras, so I'm very involved in music. The atonal movement started in the early 20th century. And as God and specifically Christianity were dying, atonal music is an oxymoron. Either there's tonality or there is no music. I mean, there are sounds out of instruments, but that doesn't make it music. And I asked John Elliott Gardner, one of the greatest conductors living and an author of a major biography of Bach. I asked him on my show, do you think that the death of God in the West has killed the arts? And he said, yes. And I was shocked. I really expected him to say, oh no, of course not. You could have great music in a secular world, but we don't.
No. I mean, some of the guys walked up to the line without crossing over it necessarily. Yeah, when you get into Schoenberg and Berg and the rest of them, it's nightmarish to listen to. It's interesting the first time, but not as a steady diet. Thank you. But Mahler in his 10th symphony in the second movement was two tones short of a 12-tone row. I mean, he looked at it staring into the abyss in his 10th and backed off from it. So there's something there to be explored of that chaos, but within the construct of tonality, because
that's the point. That's right. Look, there's dissonance in Bruckner, one of my favorite composers. He will have some dissonance, but it's always because, of course, there is a time for the antichrist, if you will, the anti-music. But Mahler, whom I know pretty well, is of course tonal. He was
great.
The guy was a giant of tonality. So you know, give me an atonal Berg. You mentioned Berg, so I don't want to get too involved. Most people don't know what we're talking about, and which is sad, but it's true. Berg wrote, Wozzeck is actually interesting to me, and so is his violin concerto. But nevertheless, the rule remains atonal music is an oxymoron. Even Leonard Bernstein said that atonal music is an oxymoron.
So the good news is that academic classical music may have gone off and wandered into atonality and screeching nonsense. The stuff that we associate with tonality, the 19th century European romantic tradition, moved into the movies where it flourishes, where it has a vast audience. And that's great. That's good. But architecture is the most public of the arts. You cannot listen to an atonal symphony if you don't want to, but you have to walk around that courthouse.
Right. That's right. And the I would say, using this as a metaphor, that sculpture has become atonal, but you can't avoid it, whereas you can't avoid atonal music. Likewise, painting. I mean, throwing, standing on a ladder and heaving paint onto a canvas is another example. I mean, we have a great video up at PragerU, a 5-minute video from a wonderful painter, Robert Florzak. It's one of the most, our videos all have millions of views. We get 1 billion views a year, so they obviously have a lot of views. His is one of the most popular, I think in the top 10. He spoke about the crisis of modern art. And he gives you examples you see in the video. You know, for example, I remember one of them at the Toronto Museum, and it was just white. The entire canvas was white. Yes. And that it's like the idiot piece. What is it called? 4:36, I think.
4:33 by Cage.
Sorry. Yeah. What is it called? For what?
I think it's 4:33 by Cage.
4:33. Fine. 4:33. A pianist comes out and sits at the piano and plays no notes. And that's taken seriously. And people applaud at the end and so on. I mean, the emperor is not only naked in the arts today, but is suffering from pneumonia because it's so cold. And we're still supposed to say, oh, what beautiful clothing.
Mm-hmm. I might argue with you about Jackson Pollock in a few instances, but you're right about Cage. And the whole idea with Cage is what Tom Wolfe was saying in The Painted Word, that in order to understand what you're looking at, you have to look at that little box, the little text that explains it. And in the case of Cage, once you understand that all the ambient sounds, all the negative things, all the notes that aren't being played makes this performance of 4:33 or 4:22 or whatever unique, then you intellectually apprehend what he's after. I mean, it's BS, but there's a theory behind it. Now, I was at the Tate Museum in London a couple of weeks ago, and they have a Hogarth exhibition. And Hogarth, you know, was the great editorial painter of his day, with these long tableaus of English life and the rest of it. Well, they assigned the young woke museum curators to rewrite the captions that went with Hogarth. And you can imagine how that turned out.
Well, I'll bet the following words appear: intersectionality,
bing,
matrix,
bing,
agency,
ding, 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 ding. Mm-hmm. Could it be that this wood that Hogarth's subject sits upon was transported from another continent along the same maritime lanes as carried slaves? Is the darkness of the wood not then a commentary on the voices? I'm serious.
That's right. I know that. The New York Times just had a review. I don't remember the painter's name. I guess a painter, where it's a large canvas on wood, and essentially, it's just a background, and on it is a knife. I think it's a knife and a fork. I don't know if you caught that. It was New York Times gave it an incredibly serious review. I read much of the review on my radio show, and it has nothing to do with anything there. I mean, it's inherently meaningless.
Mm-hmm.
The celebration of meaninglessness is what we have now instead of the celebration of meaning, because meaning suggests God, meaning suggests religion, meaning suggests bourgeois values, which they loathe.
So it unmoors us from our cultural heritage, which wasn't really the objective at the beginning. When painting started to dissolve into more gauzy forms, expressionism, impressionism, the rest of it, they weren't trying to destroy Western civilization. They were trying to come up with a new paradigm that still was within this. It just wasn't academic and cold and dead as they thought the academic Beaux-Art world was. But when you look at the sculpture today, and you mentioned sculpture, you know, Richard Serra, tilted arc, a huge piece of tetanus inducing iron stretched across a plaza. Even, you know, the Calder, well, the Calders actually have some humanism to them, but they seem intent on creating a world in which there is no recollection of the possibility of beauty. And again, why so many people, was it their own internal adolescent nihilism that drew this to it simply because it's dark and interesting as opposed to something that's sunny and balanced and symmetrical?
I think in part it goes to all of these things. And it also goes back to being a child where you want to rebel against your daddy. And, you know, daddy believed in all order, law and order, in beauty. And if daddy believed it, look, one of the a former president of, I think it was Brown University, said that the purpose of college is to have you either question or reject, I don't remember which verb, your father's values, which is idiocy. The purpose of an education is to have you explore truth and beauty. Whether it accords with your father's values is a non sequitur.
In a similar vein, David W. I'm sorry, I'm not pronouncing your name correctly, so I'm not going to mangle it. Asks Dennis, I remember hearing you say that Haydn was your favorite composer. Why Haydn, and what are some of your favorite Haydn works?
Yes, Haydn has been my one whole life consistent companion in classical music. He wrote by far the most symphonies. He wrote 104 symphonies. He wrote 52 piano sonatas. I don't remember the number of quartets. He's the father of the quartet. He's the father of the symphony. And he is way, way underappreciated. He's intellectually appreciated, but not artistically and emotionally. So here is where I stand today. I have a trio of my three desert island composers, and they are Bach, Haydn, and Beethoven. And so if I want to get in touch with God, I listen to Bach. If I want to just be happier, I listen to Haydn. And if I just want musical intensity and transport it into a world of genius, I go to Beethoven.
When we spoke last time, a couple of years ago, when you were on the Ricochet podcast, I asked you if you only had to listen to one, Mahler or Bruckner, which would you choose?
What did I say?
You said, and it didn't surprise me because I was feeling the same way at the same time. You said Bruckner. Mm-hmm. And I thought about that an awful lot. And I thought, I wonder if you would answer it differently, because I've come to believe Mahler because there's simply more stories. There's more places. There's more moods. There's more views. As much as I love the alpine vistas of a great Bruckner, I'm not sure that I would like to trade that for the little humble meadow cowbell and the austere trumpets and the dramatics and the Weltschmerz and, you know, the whole humanity that is Mahler, more, I think, than Bruckner.
Well, the first half of my life, I always said Mahler, and this second half, I not only say Bruckner again, but more than ever. I'll come back to explain it, but I'll just tell you how much I love him. My wife and I, right before, a month before the lockdowns, we flew from LA to Cleveland just to hear Bruckner's Fifth. With the Cleveland Orchestra. And it was worth every penny and all the effort. I got front row seats. That's where I want to sit in a concert. And we went nuts. So my answer to you is this. I know the Mahler Symphony so well that I don't ache to hear it that often. Whereas Bruckner, even if you know Bruckner well, you discover new things each time. And I don't discover new things each time in most. Look, Mahler's Fifth, which is my favorite Mahler symphony, is just genius. I would have a newcomer to music listen to Mahler before Bruckner. Mm-hmm. But yes, Bruckner is mind-blowing to me.
Yep. Back to the free speech issue. Sam B says, we hear a lot about how conservatives ought to speak out more. Considering how hard it is, how hard most people seem to find it, speaking out more, do you think it's something that can be developed? Have you seen how that develops? I'm not sure if he means in social media or...
Yeah, this is truly as important a question as could be posed. The answer is, can people develop courage? Because most of us are not born with courage. Courage must be sought. So a handful of people are inherently courageous, but it's very rare. So I have a speech. It took me a long time to prepare, and I only gave it once, how to become a courageous person. And it begins, believe it or not, with a very simple statement. I want to be courageous. The way to be courageous is to want to be courageous. Act on it, and I'll give you a wonderful little story, if I may. I discovered a brilliant, spectacular young woman. I mean, really young, 21. She's now 22. She wrote me a letter. I don't tend to see my mail. I thank God that I opened up her mail. And the subject, I fully admit, attracted me to opening it up. But I don't even see a lot of subjects. I can't see all my mail. But anyway, it said something to the effect, Harvard student came to conservatism after reading your book. And so that intrigued me. I read it. It was very deep and very bright. And she, by coincidence, she lives in Southern California, where I live. And so I invited her to visit my show and to ask her if she would want to say on the air how she came to being a conservative. And I told her in the studio, I said, I morally am obligated to say to you that if you do speak about that, especially on my show, you may lose friends. You may even lose some relatives and you will be ridiculed at Harvard. And I made the case so convincing that she said, during a break before she was scheduled to come on, is it all right with you if I just step out and call my mom? Which I found very endearing. I was very mm-hmm. impressed that she mm-hmm. had such a relationship with her mother. And so she came back in and she said, I'm coming on. So she came on the show. And then 6 months later, I had her on again. And I said, so what happened after you came on my show? And she said, I then went through 2 weeks of hell. Those are her words. And she said exactly what you predicted happened. I lost friends, not relatives in her case, but I did lose friends. And of course, I got my fair amount of ridicule at Harvard. And then what happened? I said, what happened after your 2 weeks of hell? She said, then I went to heaven. And I said, oh, really? What do you mean by that? She said, well, among other things, I slept better, literally slept better, because I was no longer a fake. I came out of the closet. Mm-hmm. And when I came out of the closet, I lost friends, but I gained new friends who shared my values, or what I call kindred spirits. And she ended up a net gainer mm-hmm. of people. Other people with our values can find you if you're in the closet.
Right.
So stepping out of the closet means stones will be thrown at you, but so will roses. And it's worth it.
There are some people who are going to say, and I use that framing of the argument not to relieve myself of the opportunity, the responsibility of saying it myself, because I don't believe it. But there are some people who say that really your approach, the persuasive approach, the civility, the idea of finding where you disagree, moving from there to treating each other with respect, that that's hopeless, that the left is simply out for blood. And the best thing for the right to do is to play pure power politics and smash mouth the rest of it. And there's no place anymore for civilized dialogue. It's just blood. It's just bloody combat and victory. Nice for your young lady, but most of us are going to be fired out here. So we're going to go raw. And I don't like that, because that's just that there's no civil comedy you can get. There's no national spirit you can get out of that if everybody's two camps at each other's throats. And I don't think we're there yet.
I think both are true. I think you have to fight. I mean, there are people who just need to be fought. And I fight a tremendous amount. I try to fight civilly, but I fight. I don't think they're mutually exclusive. My biggest aim right now is not civil dialogue with leftists, because as much as I ache for it, frankly, they never come on my show and they never invite me. We are thrilled. Every conservative I know in the media are thrilled, or is thrilled, to have any leftist come on.
Mm-hmm.
I have offered tens of thousands of dollars to any left-wing New York Times columnist to debate me. I will, in other words, I'll pay them to debate me. Mm-hmm. And I'm better known than them. It's not like, oh, well, why would we stoop so low? I'm far better known than I think any New York Times columnist.
Not by the right people.
I'm sorry?
Not by the right people. Well, you're known by those people out there who listen to the radio.
Oh, no,
the,
yeah, right.
Not well, the elite.
No, I'm known by the wrong people, too. But that's a separate issue. Anyway, they don't come on. If CNN said, we'll only have you on if you fly to Atlanta for 5 minutes, I will fly to Atlanta for 5 minutes to go on CNN. And I will fly them to come to my show. Mm-hmm. But they don't. They don't debate. Larry Elder, who's a dear friend of mine, and whom I'm proud to say I brought to radio, and he, of course, got national attention in his gubernatorial run in California. There was no black leftist who would debate him. The Ta-Nehisi Coates would not show up, or Ibram X. Kendi wouldn't show up, or the woman who invented the 1619 Project. They wouldn't debate Larry Elder. You would end up feeling sorry for them, because he would run circles around them intellectually and morally and gently. You know, you wouldn't curse them or yell at them, but they don't debate. They can't debate. There are many reasons for that. And one is, we know all of their arguments and they know none of ours.
Mm-hmm. That's a great thing about being on the left when you're young and inhabiting intellectually all those things, feeling them in your guts and your bones and your marrow, and then having sort of an awakening later on. You know what you believed and why you believed it. And the fact that, you know, we believe what we believe for reasons, and they seem to believe that we believe what we do because we want death, misery, oppression, oligarchy, and all the other things that they ascribe to the right. We got to go. And I was going to ask you a question on the way out, like, what is the greatest 1960s pop organ song, and why is it The Beast by Milt Bruckner?
But oh, that's funny that I didn't even know. That's not the happy organ, is it?
It's the one you play every week. It's that great swing.
Yes, that's right. That's the one. Yeah. Okay, that's not the happy organ.
Call it a happy organ.
By the way, I don't think it's organ. It's piano, I think.
Well, there's a piano to it, but Bruckner was an organ guy. And I didn't know.
I don't know pop music well at all. But yes, I play it every week. I'm honored that you know that. And it's a fantastic piece. And I've looked him up to hear other things. But that's really terrific.
That's the one. Hat tip to the producer, because those are the unsung guys who make your show as great as it is. But of course, without you, it wouldn't be the Dennis Prager Show. And we thank you so much for joining us. Matt, the Rational Passover Haggadah.
That's
right?
It.
Right? Did I get it there? I didn't get Haggadah.
And the Haggadah. Rational
Bible. Can't believe it.
Thank you so much. Yes, sir.
Thank you, Dennis. It's been a pleasure.
Mine.